with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Some Greeks who had come to worship at the Passover feast came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Amen, amen, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls on the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. The Father will honor whoever serves me. I am troubled now, yet what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. But it was for this purpose that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd there heard it and said it was thunder. But others says an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered and said, "This voice did not come for my sake, but for yours. Now is the time of judgment on this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself." He said this indicating the kind of death that he would die. The Gospel of the Lord. Well, here we are, 2 weeks away from Easter. Jesus is trying to prepare his disciples and anyone that would listen, as well as maybe himself, what they were about to face. I still believe that the disciples were having trouble understanding some of the things that were going to happen. Earlier, during the Lenten season, we heard him talk to them about not to say anything until after the resurrection. Sure, that's fine. What is this resurrection they're talking about? So they still have a lot of things on their mind that they don't understand. In our gospel reading today, Jesus talks about a grain of wheat. Now, being in a rural community like this, we understand that that grain of wheat is nothing more than that until it's planted in the soil. At that time, it dies, but it produces a plant that will produce much fruit. So Christ must die, is that right? So he can produce much fruit from his death. And what is that fruit? Is it all of us? More than just the Jewish people and the Gentiles, the Greeks. It's everyone that he gathers to his church that he starts at this time. So what about us? Are we also to die? What fruit do we produce in our death? In our death, here on earth, if we have followed Christ, we will be with him all eternity. We will gain a life that is much more productive. I guess you might say we get to stay with him. We get to proclaim his glory day in and day out. Each and every day, we must take up our cross and follow Jesus. That way we can lose this life and gain eternity with Christ. So So how are we coming along with our preparation for the Easter season? You know, there's still a lot of things we can do to take up our cross and follow Him, pray, and seek His understanding. This past weekend, the deacons and their wives from the Grand Island Diocese were on retreat. It was our fourth annual one that we had the opportunity to pray, discussion, reconciliation, and we had two masses. So many blessings and graces that we have. Sunday morning after Mass, we sat down in a big circle, all of us, and started talking about the graces and blessings that we had received during that weekend. One thing that really stuck in my mind, and I've thought about all week, and it was a comment made by Deacon Bill Boothka from St. Leo's in Grand Island. He said, you know, Christmas was the promise. The answer is Easter. And I've thought about that a lot this week, a lot. You know, we read throughout the Old Testament, Isaiah, Jeremiah, we hear from Elijah and Moses, about the coming of our Savior. And as the deacon said, He does that at Christmas time. Every Christmas, every end of Advent, we celebrate God's promise to us, the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the age of 30, He started His ministry. And look what He did in 3 short years. We found our answer at Easter. That answer is Christ is our Messiah. He died on the cross for everyone's sin. Everyone. Those before Him, those during the time of life, and everyone since. I've really, like I said, I've spent a lot of time thinking about that promise and answer. Where it puts us. Is our promise in baptism, our promise to God? Baptism, confirmation, the first Eucharist? Where's our answer back to Him for all the blessings and graces He's given us? Do we tell Him thank you enough? Or are we constantly in prayer asking for something? All of our blessings and gifts, our families, our children, our grandchildren. Do we see it here at Mass? If we go to a retreat, for some of us, did we see it at ordination? Where is our answer and promise? This past week, 2 more gentlemen attended a retreat, the same retreat that 5 of us did a year ago, to prepare our yes again to the Lord, to be in front of the bishop at ordination. We pray that Eric and Neil will be ready to give their promises to the bishop at ordination. And then on Tuesday, one of the most beautiful masses that you can attend is a chrism mass here at St. Pat's at 4 o'clock. To see all these wonderful priests here once again saying yes to the bishop. And all of us that are here that can hear it. Our journeys keep moving ahead, all of us in search of our answer. I do believe that answer we are looking for is right here in front of us at the altar, where we gather for Mass. Above the altar, we see our Lord on a crucifix. Shortly, He will be raised above the altar when Father raises the host. Look closely, and I believe that you can see Jesus in that host. He is with us. He is with us right now. You can feel His presence. Just open your hearts. Maybe close your eyes for a couple of minutes, and He is here. This is the answer we all look for. Yes, we only have 2 weeks left to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. We will see the answer fulfilled once again. And the answer is His love for all of us. his true love. Remember, at the Easter vigil, if you will, we have new members that will be seeing this for the first time through baptism, through confirmation, through their first communion. Pray for them for the next couple of weeks, that they will see, feel, and taste the presence of our Lord when they come into full communion with the church. Let us be ever mindful of Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, knowing what he is about to face, death on the cross, all for us, totally unselfish love. Take time in the next couple weeks. Go to adoration. Go to reconciliation. Pray that your heart, mind, and soul is open to his love, our answer. Christ knows what he is about to go through. He is doing this all for us. Reflect on those blessings and graces and joys he has given to us. I'd like to close this morning with a prayer from St. Thomas Aquinas. Some of you heard this before. Grant me, O Lord my God, a mind to know you, a heart to seek you, wisdom to find you, conduct pleasing to you, faithful perseverance in waiting for you, and a hope of finally embracing you. Amen.